So I've been laser focused on this one question. And the question is whether or not large language models can actually reason. Because right now, we are just not sure. And the big problem is we're pouring in all this money and all these resources to get these models to get better. We know the scaling law. We know that if we increase compute, that models get better. But we don't know if this also applies to reasoning. We don't know if this also applies to out-of-distribution data it has not seen before data. They have a deep understanding of the world like we do, then they are able to explore new things that we have not explored yet. But therefore, they need to be able to reason outside of the training distribution. So I've been scavenging the web for scholarly articles about this to see if the research is pointing in a certain direction. There's so much research going on trying to probe these models. It's almost like psychology, you know, trying to see how they work and if they can generalize or not. And one of these articles I read really caught my attention. I've been thinking about it a lot because they are claiming that they are directly showing that models do not generalize outside of distribution and that scaling them won't help them with generalization on out of distribution data. And that's a big thing, you know, because the whole hope right now is on scaling. And if scaling doesn't fix outside of distribution reasoning, then we might need another architecture, because then we will never have the AI researcher. And I don't want to just accept the conclusion of the paper, because there's so much research showing us that that's not the case. For example, take all these Grokking papers. If you're not familiar with it, Grokking is when you let the model run for much longer than normally. It starts to overfit, which is what you would expect. It starts to memorize the training data. And at some point, it shoots up and it becomes good at generalization and it's out of training data. Performance goes up. And that's weird because we train it on in data distribution and it gets better on out of training data distribution. The point is, Grokking shows that they do improve their performance on out of training data distributions. This is not in line with this current paper and it's conflicting. What I think is happening, the paper itself addresses this too, is that in Grokking papers, they use super simple tasks. Like they'll talk about composition. They'll be like, my brother is Hank and his brother is Johnny. So Johnny is my brother. That's a rather simple task. They test it on these kind of tasks. While this paper uses a much harder task. They use things from material science. So they'll take an element, for example, and an element has many attributes, and then they'll try to predict a certain energy of this new element or this new molecule based on what they've learned from these previous elements. And the relationships there are just a lot more vague. They're more hard. They're not so straightforward as Hank is my brother, Johnny is Hank's brother, so Johnny is my brother. They're much complexer than that. And that's why Grokking only works on simple rules. And that generalization on out-of-distribution data will not happen if the rules are complex. And that's a massive problem, of course, for us. Because that means that large language models can never generalize on hard out-of-distribution problems. So they will always be limited. But I think there's a more nuanced answer, actually. Because it's not just about the complexity of the rule it has to infer from the data. It's also about how much different data examples there are. Because imagine this, right? If you see like a ton of data and the rule you have to infer is really hard. Every time you see a new data point and you use your current hypothesis, it's not going to work. Because your current hypothesis is just memorization. And it's a new data point, so it won't work. So every time you get a new data point, you get punished if you haven't generalized. And at some point, you will generalize. And besides this fact, it's also really hard to memorize a lot of data points. It just costs a lot of parameter space. And regularization, the thing that actually drives Grokking, makes it so that we don't want to memorize that much because it just costs too much parameter space. While generalizations are really cheap to store. Like, for example, if you try addition, if you say like 1 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 2 is 3, 1 plus 4 is 5, then you can try to memorize all these combinations, or you can just learn what addition means. And to learn what addition means is actually what we do, because of course it takes way too much space to memorize everything. But there are cases in which memorization doesn't cost that much, and it's actually harder to get the rule to infer the rule, like with material science, for example, because there are only 118 elements. So you can just easily memorize the 118 elements with all the attributes. You're not gonna try to figure out some complex rule through which you can predict an attribute of an element. That's just too much work and it's too hard. So these models face the same problem. There's this balance between the complexity of the rule that has to be inferred and the amount of different data. The more diverse the data set, the easier it's going to be to generalize. And the harder the rule, the harder it's going to be to generalize. So there's a balance between these two. And this means that when we're looking at scaling laws and when we're looking at the performance increase of the models, they are not increasing all across the board. They're increasing on a certain category of problems. And these problems are all in distribution. Now, this is where I agree with the paper. They mainly increase in distribution tasks. What I disagree with is that they only increase in distribution tasks, because Grokking has showed us that they can also increase in out-of-distribution tasks. Therefore, they are increasing in distribution tasks and are increasing in performance in out-of-distribution tasks that are simple enough, like Grokking. And not only simple enough, because they can be hard, but if they're hard, there has to be a lot of data diversity, like we've discussed before. The more diversity there is, the harder it becomes to memorize it, because there's just a lot to memorize. And the more data diversity there is, the easier it is for a model to keep testing its hypothesis. So whether or not a model will truly generalize on something is dependent on this balance. Regularization normally causes models to generalize, but that's only because memorization is parameter-wise more expensive than generalization. But this is not the case with material science. It's not the case when the data diversity is so low and the complexity of the underlying problem is so big. Then the regularization will actually cause the model to memorize instead of generalize. And that's what they find in the paper. They find that as you train these models for longer, they start to memorize more. They start to become worse on out-of-distribution data. And that's because of regularization. That's because regularization pushes them to memorize in this case. So that regularization causes models to generalize is not always the case. It's only the case when data diversity is high enough and the rule to be inferred is simple enough. And this is actually something they also see in the paper itself, because they also tested it on a subset of the features of the original elements and a subset of the predicted variable. So the whole problem in itself was easier. So you had a lower dimension input space and a lower dimension output space. The possible connections, if you will, are much less. The possible connections from input to output are much fewer, right? If you have an input space of one dimension and you're predicting one other variable, there's only so much complexity there can be between one variable and another. There is much more complexity that can be between 100 variables and one other, or 100 variables and 100 other variables can be even more complex. So what we see is that in this case, because they're taking a subset of the input and a subset of the output, the total complexity of the problem becomes easier. And they're doing it with the structure of elements. When you specifically look at the structure of elements, the rule to infer the structure of a new element is actually much simpler than what they did before, where they tried to predict the overall characteristics of an element. And in this specific case, they do see that more data causes the model and more compute causes the model to generalize better. So this, again, confirms this idea that there are certain problems that are just too complex and have too little data diversity for models to truly converge on it, even with regularization. Well, especially with regularization, because it actually makes the things worse. So with this subset of problems that models will never learn, what are we gonna do? Now, at first, I'll say it's not that big of a problem, because like I said, if I asked you to a test on 118 elements and you had to guess some attribute of these elements, then you're just going to memorize that attribute. You're not going to infer it from the other attributes, because that's too complex. And models will do this too. So they're just being human in that way. They're just being logical. But the one difference is that humans are able to say, well, look, I only have 118 elements and I can just memorize it, but just for the sake of it, I'm gonna try to learn what the relation is between all these attributes and this attribute I'm trying to predict. I'm just gonna truly understand the relationships. And one way we would solve this problem is by looking at 100 of these elements, and let's say we want to predict some kind of energy. We're gonna look at some aspects of the elements, like maybe the weight of it, maybe the size of it, and we're able to see some patterns, we're able to see some relationships, and we get an hypothesis. And this hypothesis is then tested on the 18 elements that we did not train on. If we are able to predict the energy of these elements correctly, then we know that we have the correct hypothesis. And if it isn't correct, we keep making new hypotheses and testing it. And models can actually do this too, and it's called K-out cross-validation. Normally it's used not to train models, but to find the best parameters, so not to set the weights, but other specifics about the model itself. But I'm actually suggesting here is that we are starting to use cross-validation as a way to train the model. Because the only way to get good out-of-distribution performance is by training it on out-of-distribution data. You might say, well, if we train it on out-of-distribution data, doesn't it make the out-of-distribution data in distribution? And no, not necessarily. We are not gonna show the model the out-of-distribution data. We are just gonna let it try it out. Let it infer a hypothesis on the 100 elements. And then it's gonna test if it works for the 18 elements that are left out. It will probably not work the first couple hundred times, but at some point it will. And because it doesn't see the true value of the 18 elements, it cannot memorize them. It's just testing them. Whereas it's kind of like testing if code works by running it on examples, but not actually seeing the examples themselves. So all in all, super interesting paper. I think it highlights a lot of the limitation of current architectures and current ways of learning, and it actually made me a bit more nuanced on the fact that large language models can just become AGI if you scale them up. I think there are some asterisks on it right now,